Hi, everyone. This is Dr. Cheryl Selman, and welcome to What Women Must Know. It's great having you join me today and every week, because this is an opportunity to truly get empowered with the kind of information that really makes a difference in your life and in your health, the health of your family, friends, colleagues, and to really open up the possibilities of how many solutions there are to our well-being. So thank you for joining me, and I hope you will be joining me every week. And to do that, by the way, if you can't listen live, you can always go to my Facebook page, which is What Women Must Know, because I post these archive shows and with show notes and things of that nature, so you can get more information there. And also, you can go to my website, which is Dr. Cheryl Selman, and that's drcherylselman.com. Opt in there, and I send out the archive shows to you every week, and there's lots of other additional information and blogs. So that's a way to stay in touch and just keep learning and keep growing and keep getting empowered. I love using that word, being empowered, empowerment, because I think that really is the name of the game. And to continue learning and growing and getting the knowledge truly empowers you so you can make informed decisions for your health and well-being. And that's really what my goal is, to allow you to have the knowledge and the resources to make the best decisions for you. And we have a really special topic today. And actually, my guest today, Dr. Eric Balcavage, has been on my show before, and I invited him back because he has such a wealth of information. I'm so happy he's able to make the time. And today we're going to be talking about a subject that actually I'm very passionate about, and I have been studying for 6 or more years about this, and not many people really appreciate the topic. So what is the topic? We're going to be talking about why broccoli seed extract is a must for preventing cancer, diabetes, and so much more. We're going to get into this topic, dive deep into an understanding of the research and why this is one of my favorite products, and it's one of my personal products in my daily protocol. So just let me share a little bit about Eric. Dr. Eric Balcavage is the owner and founder of Rejuvagen, a functional medicine clinic in Glen Mills, Pennsylvania. He is nationally recognized speaker and educator on various health-related topics, including thyroid physiology, biophysiology, detoxification, oxidative stress, methylation, and chronic illness. He has been in private practice in Glen Mills, Pennsylvania since 1996. He is a certified nutrition specialist, a certified functional medicine practitioner, board certified in integrative medicine, along with being a licensed chiropractor in Pennsylvania. He is the co-host of Thyroid Answers podcast, and the podcast that he hosts focuses on answering the pressing questions from those who are suffering with chronic hyperthyroid symptoms and can't get answers elsewhere. And that was the topic of my previous show. So if you haven't listened to the previous interview I did all about the thyroid, then you can go back to the archives and get the knowledge that we were learning there. So first of all, let me welcome Dr. Eric Balcavage to the show. Hello, Dr. Eric.
How are you?
I'm good, and I'm so happy
another,
you're...
episode.
Yeah, here, another opportunity, and I'm really happy you've given us some time, because I know you have a really busy schedule, but this is such an important topic, and I really wanted to have the time to discuss it, and why I think this is really important, why I make it as one of the standard supplements in my protocol, and really enlighten people more on what broccoli seed extract is all about. So I'm just going to have you jump in, and let's start talking about this fascinating subject and why this is really coming to the fore as a very important nutrient and supplement to incorporate in all of our protocols.
Well, when we're talking about sulforaphane, you know, the question would be, why does anybody need it, and what's the benefit? And the challenges... the biggest challenge we're faced with today, at least in the U.S., is chronic low-grade stress and chronic low-grade inflammation. So if that's our primary challenge that we have, then we have to, and that's creating a lot of our health issues, then we have to consider what's the best way to support it. And that's where we potentially run into challenges, because we can do, we can take, you know, we can take medications that are anti-inflammatory, and they have an effect and a side effect, unfortunately, or we could bombard the body with supplements that are antioxidant or anti-inflammatory, which can have a benefit but can also have side effects. So the answer is, how do we address this chronic low-grade inflammation, and what's the best way to reduce it or manage it? And based on a lot of literature and research that's coming out, this food-based product called sulforaphane, which comes from broccoli sprouts primarily as one of the greatest sources of sulforaphane, has been shown to have probably some of the most significant impact on naturally supporting the anti-inflammatory, antioxidant systems without being problematic.
So I have a question to jump in with here. How do we know if we have low-grade inflammation occurring in our bodies?
So symptomatically, it would be tough, because there isn't there's not a low-grade inflammation warning light that comes on, right? But almost any symptom could be caused by some type of low-grade inflammation. But if we want to, we can go look at some lab tests and say, okay, are there lab tests that can be looked at to help me identify inflammation in the body? And there are, that it can be done in almost any lab. We can look at markers like CRP, homocysteine. We could look at something like elevations of uric acid, fibrinogen. We could look at elevations of something called reverse T3. We could look at the beginnings of insulin resistance by looking at a fasting insulin, fasting blood sugar, hemoglobin A1C. We could look at elevations in even like our lipids as a potential indicator that there's some level of inflammation. Liver tests, AST, ALT, GGT, lower levels of bilirubin would be another marker. So there's lots of tests that are available on blood work that would confirm it. But if you are struggling with, or want to, you know, if somebody's sitting in the audience saying, well, how do I know? If you've been diagnosed with high blood pressure, you have an inflammatory condition going on. If you've been diagnosed with inflammation, with diabetes or prediabetes, you've got an inflammatory condition going on. If you've got belly fat accumulating, you know, what some people refer to as a muffin top or a Milwaukee goiter, like a big belly, you have an inflammatory process. Yeah, you have an inflammatory process going on. If you have swelling in your legs or edema or your thyroid's become dysfunctional, there's a good chance you have an inflammatory condition going on. If you have been diagnosed with sleep apnea, you have a chronic inflammatory condition going on. So almost every chronic health care problem that we have, and especially in the United States, is really at the root of it is an inflammatory condition.
Yeah, so that's so interesting, because first of all, I want to say with the blood work, even though the indications will be there if you know how to read them, if you look at the blood work and get it evaluated by a traditional allopathic doctor, they probably will miss it, because they don't delve into the realm of the indicators of inflammation. They're just looking for some, you know, serious markers of dysfunction going on in your body. So you have to have somebody who's that detective, right, who really has the sensitivity to connect all the dots to see if it's in a blood test. But what you are saying is so powerful. If you are dealing with any of these health conditions, basically every serious or even discomfort conditions, are driven by inflammation. So we can assume that inflammation is a powerful generator of the health challenges that the majority of people are experiencing. Even if people can't find a root cause for something, there's inflammation involved. So being able to manage inflammation is really important, which is, you know, brings us back to the research that has been done on the active ingredient of broccoli seeds, the sprouts, actually, from Johns Hopkins. Well, let me just say, before we get into that subject, when I was learning how to do genomic testing over 6-7 years ago, I was an early adapter to this, Eric, one of the strategies that was highly recommended was the use of broccoli seed extract for addressing the indicators based on someone's software glitches that predispose them to things like inflammation or oxidative stress or detoxification. So that's when I became aware of the role of the sulforaphane, the active ingredient of broccoli seed extracts, in addressing so many of the issues. So it's like one product was so powerful in the many pathways that we need to have addressed to bring us back to health. And so that's just kind of my preamble of my interest and very profound awareness of the role that this particular molecule plays in so many facets of our health. And that's what you're so good at explaining. So can we talk a little bit about how it was discovered and the research that's gone on at Johns Hopkins University?
Yeah, I mean, I think Johns Hopkins has probably been the leaders in taking a look at sulforaphane and what the potential things it might be able to do. Jed Fahey is one of those people that, if you Google that name, you'll see he's almost on, his name's almost on every paper that you see on sulforaphane, and they've been at the forefront. So, you know, essentially with their literature and their research is they're finding that broccoli seeds, but broccoli sprouts, which is that 3 to 5 day growth of broccoli. And most people think of broccoli, they think of the big thing, the big head that you buy and eat. But it's the sprout. It's that first 3 to 5 days of growth out of the seed that has probably the greatest concentration potential of sulforaphane. And when we harvest those broccoli sprouts in that 3 to 5 day window and you capture the desiccated product of broccoli sprout, within that you have the potential of this thing called sulforaphane. So how sulforaphane is produced, it's not in itself like in the plant. What happens is there's two components. There's something called glucuronin, and there's an enzyme called myrosinase. And when the little plant breaks down, those two things come together and produce this product called sulforaphane. And it's sulforaphane that does all these fantastic things by driving up one primary enzyme in the body that really supports about 200 different antioxidant, anti-inflammatory, and detoxification pathways, something called NRF2. And it was Fahey and his group who really did, were the pioneers in a lot of this research.
So the important point we need to make is that you cannot go to a health food store and buy sulforaphane. It's made in the body, providing you have the right enzymes when you take foods like broccoli seed extracts or these. And you can't really get enough from just growing your own broccoli sprouts. I have to make that comment as well, although if you wanted to use them as a food source, they're highly nutritious, but not for the therapeutic levels we're talking about in our conversation today. So that often comes up for people, and I just want to clarify that. So so this molecule, well, go ahead.
Yeah, I would say I don't know if I'd agree with all of that. I think from a support perspective, if somebody wanted to grow broccoli sprouts, they could consume those on a regular on a daily basis and get really they could get a concentration of sulforaphane from what they grow. The challenge is the first part you said where you can't get them you can't get sulforaphane from a can't purchase it at the grocery store. You're typically not purchasing sulforaphane as a supplement. What you're doing is you're purchasing a broccoli sprout product as a supplemental form. And there's a lot of issues with how that broccoli sprout is processed. Does it have an active enzyme to activate the glucoraphanin that's in the broccoli sprout product into the sulforaphane? So it's when those two things, myrosinase and glucoraphanin, come together, that's when we get the sulforaphane. Sulforaphane is extremely unstable. So to have it in a capsule form or tablet form is near impossible. But if somebody did want to grow broccoli sprouts in their kitchen or out of a garden, could they consume enough of those to get a therapeutic benefit? They could. They just have to eat a ton of it. And not everybody likes the flavor of it. So we're talking maybe half of a large mason jar every day to get that, maybe to get that 60 milligrams, which we consider as being like somewhere in that 40 to 60 milligram range is the optimal range of sulforaphane. So it's just difficult. So the best thing to do is, buying a supplemental product, it can be the best way to do it on a regular basis, because the challenge is you want to harvest those sprouts in that 3 to 5 day window. Are you going to be able to eat them fast enough? And then once they start to break down, you're losing the sulforaphane potential. If you take them and say, well, I'll harvest them and I'll put them in the refrigerator or in the freezer, as soon as the plant starts to break down, you're losing the sulforaphane potential, which is one of the reasons why it makes it really difficult to buy broccoli sprouts and get value out of them at your grocery store, which is probably what you are kind of referring to, is because the sprouts don't have a long shelf life. And as soon as the sprouts start to break down, then the myrosinase in the sprout and the glucoraphanin in the sprout start to combine and produces sulforaphane. And the sulforaphane is once it's produced, it goes away really fast. So sprouts are to purchase on your own at the grocery store expensive, and they probably aren't giving you sulforaphane potential because they've probably just been sitting too long.
Well, I'm exhausted just thinking about growing them and making sure I'm eating enough and keeping them for the period of time. And, that's a lot of work. So I prefer the supplement. It makes my life a lot easier.
Yeah. And I don't blame you, but I think it's important to let people know that, hey, if you want to do it, and I recommend it to my patients, but most of us are the same. We're busy and you're like, okay, I got to rotate them. I got to rinse them. And then they forget. And now they've got a jar of moldy sprouts sitting somewhere. And most people, after a short period of time, defer to, let me just take a, is there a supplement I can take? So
let's go back to the research at Johns Hopkins and Jeff Sahi. They're very excited. They were very excited. I mean, this is profound research and the implications of what sulforaphanes are enabling the body to do in terms of healing and reducing inflammation and supporting many other processes. So can we kind of explore that, Eric, and what actually was discovered that this molecule is able to do for supporting our health?
Yeah, so I think the simplest thing to do is to explain its action. So sulforaphane, once it's absorbed into the body, activates or stimulates an enzyme called NRF2. And NRF2 is made in the liver. It's the primary driver or support of anti-inflammatory processes, antioxidant processes, and detoxification process. It upregulates about 200 different genes and enzymes when it becomes active. And so sulforaphane has been shown to be highly absorbable in the GI tract. I think almost 80% of what gets into the GI tract gets absorbed. And it has a very short half-life. So the half-life is about 24 hours. So the ability for it to create toxicity is extremely low because it just doesn't hang around very often. But it's what we think is that most of the benefit that it provides isn't by being an anti-inflammatory molecule itself, but by stimulating the activation of this NRF2 molecule, which then turns a whole bunch of processes on in the body that can help support the inflammatory and oxidative and antioxidative states.
Which is so powerful, and I was given a metaphor that really helps people understand how powerful it is. So imagine that you have a string of Christmas lights, and when you take sulforaphane, it's like it plugs in, and that whole string of lights will light up. So that's the action. You're activating all these other genes that are protective and beneficial for our health and well-being and healing.
Absolutely, and that's really where I see the huge benefits of sulforaphane over a lot of other things, because you know what we've learned to do is everybody's popping Advil, Tylenol, you know, whatever it is to reduce their inflammation, not realizing that though if you take those things on a regular basis, you're totally and you may be totally inhibiting inflammation and the cell's ability to produce free radicals or some oxidation products. And we need inflammation and we need some level of free radical formation as part of our growth and healing process. We don't want too much, but we need some. And so those products can actually inhibit NRF2 and prevent the body's natural signaling of all of these pathways. And so instead of trying to work in place of the body's natural anti-inflammatory antioxidant systems, sulforaphane actually works to boost the natural process. So we don't have to take a bunch of individual products to try and stop fully stop the anti-inflammatory or the inflammatory or oxidative stress process. The other concern is even with products that we utilize a lot in functional medicine, if you're using things, catalase, vitamin E, all these glutathione, NAC, all these one-off products, you take that supplement, and that supplement that you're taking may also inhibit NRF2. So you're taking it for the right, the idea is right. Hey, I'm going to support maybe if somebody's taking N-acetylcysteine to support their glutathione levels, the idea may be great or might be right, but the problem is if you are taking the product and it's actually inhibiting NRF2, now you're turning off 200 genes and enzymes by taking one product instead of just supporting NRF2, which will turn all those pieces on. And so the one-off products that we often take, like vitamin E, vitamin C, glutathione, NAC, once those products are used, especially things like, you know, people who like to take a lot of glutathione, that glutathione becomes, once it's used, becomes a free radical itself. And if we can't recycle it, now it adds to our oxidative stress. Sulforaphane won't do that because it's pushing the NRF2 process, which will support the process and not inhibit itself.
Now, this is such an important point, and it deserves to, you know, have to be emphasized, because we can be, you know, we can think we're doing more for our health by including so many of these products that you're talking about, NAC and glutathione, and just, you know, we want to manage inflammation, we want to help with detoxification. So we take all these supplements, but the missing piece that is so profound that you just said is that What we are not being told is that taking these individual products, rather than something that can support the regeneration of these systems that we want regenerated through taking these products, can actually impair function in our body.
Absolutely. I mean, we think about, you know, if you say, hey, I need more antioxidants in my system, you can take vitamin E and you can take a bunch of these antioxidant products directly, or you can do something that supports the body's production of all of them. And that's an easier step, right? So sulforaphane, by stimulating NRF2, increases the production of all the antioxidants if they're needed, versus you just taking an antioxidant on a regular basis that does two things. One, it may suppress the amount, some of this, these free radicals that we do need as part of normal signaling in the body, and become, potentially create some free radicals, and third, actually inhibit NRF2, which right. turns off the rest of the system.
So that's important that was explained. I want to also share that what got me very interested in the broccoli sprout extract and its conversion to sulforaphane is its role in the phase 1 and phase 2 detoxification process. And this directly plays into so many health issues, including cancers, particularly estrogen-sensitive cancers. Because I work in women's health, anything that can support the reduce the risk or help in the healing of estrogen-sensitive cancers like breast cancer obviously got my attention. And maybe we can focus a little bit right now on how sulforaphanes are essential in supporting the detoxification process, and we can talk a little bit about what goes on with phase 1, phase 2, not to, you know, so we can explain things, not get people lost in too much technical terminology, but it's really important to understand what's going on in our liver and why the sulforaphanes from taking broccoli sprout extracts could be so helpful for so many of us, including men, by the way.
Yeah, so sulforaphane, when it comes to the ways that sulforaphane could help prevent or combat cancer, you know, we hate to say that, hey, this is cures this or cures that. We don't want to get ourselves ahead of the game, but there's a lot of research that shows that sulforaphane, one of the ways that it could be potentially anti-carcinogenic is that inhibits phase 1 enzymes that can activate procarcinogens. So the liver has to go through two phases, phase 1, phase 2 of detoxifications of the toxins in the body. And if we have too much phase 1, it can produce a lot of metabolites that can be carcinogenic. So that's one. Sulforaphane helps upregulate phase 2 enzymes that are responsible for the elimination of a lot of the products that are made in phase 1. So it slows down phase 1, increases phase 2 to get the toxins out of the system. It actually is involved in tumor suppressing and controlling cell cycling of different genes that may be upregulated in a cancerous state. Sulforaphane, there's research to show that it induces cancer cell death. Sulforaphane has been shown to inhibit something called NF-kappa-B, which is the big inducer of the inflammatory pathways. It can inhibit, there's research showing that it can inhibit cancer cell growth and proliferation. And it can even enhance some of the anti-cancer drugs. So, I mean, there's multiple ways that research is showing that sulforaphane and the impact it has via directly or via NRF2 can really be supportive against cancer.
Yeah, you know, that's such a powerful statement. When I was doing the nutrigenomic testings, it enabled me to look at, it's like when you have glitches in, it's when you have glitches in your software. It's not a mutated gene, it's just your software programming is not function, not giving the right instructions. And when I was doing this testing, and when I do this testing, I found, and this is what really alerted me to the problems that exist that we don't even know about, and why the broccoli sprout extract really came to the fore for me. Because when I was doing these hundreds of testing on people, I would see that the vast majority of people, men and women, had impaired abilities to properly activate the detoxification pathways. That they actually, it's almost as though our genes and our gene programming is not kept up with the environment we live in, because if that pathway is impaired and you're not, and you're living in a pure environment, pure air and water, it's not so much an issue. But if your ability to detoxify is impaired, the instructions, there are glitches in being efficient at detoxifying the in phase one and phase two, then in a very toxic environment, we're so much more vulnerable. Does that make sense so far?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. I mean, it'd be nice if we didn't have a chronically toxic environment, but that's just the world we live in today.
Right. So if we have these glitches and have impaired ability to function, have phase one break down the toxins properly, and the transition phase is impaired, and we can be, we are creating more toxic versions of those things like estrogens that are being metabolized by the liver and turning them into more dangerous free radicals instead of breaking them down and safely taking them out of the body. And this is one of the big jobs that sulforaphane enables us to do, is support this proper detoxification, and particularly of the estrogen molecules, which of course come in many forms, our own and environmental, so we can safely detoxify them and remove them out of the body rather than make them more dangerous and increase our risk for cancers.
Yeah, I think one of the things you can add to that is one of the biggest challenges we see with people who have chronic inflammatory processes going on, both men and women, is the upregulation of something called the aromatase enzymes, which can increase androgens to estrogens and raise the estrogen levels even further. And as estrogen levels rise, now you've got more potential for those estrogen metabolites to be more toxic. What's interesting is there is clinical research showing that sulforaphane is an aromatase inhibitor. And so if sulforaphane can act as an aromatase inhibitor, if you're a person who's having a lot of upregulation of that of the aromatase enzymes, sulforaphane is a great way to reduce that conversion while you address the root cause issues.
And we should also, you know, let people know that when we talk about some of the estrogen impacts, the prostate is an estrogen-sensitive organ, which most people don't know, and it really surprised mm-hmm. me when I learned it. So, again, supporting proper detoxification through the liver of these estrogen-like compounds is really critical for our health and protecting us from cancers.
Correct.
So, and it also upregulates glutathione production, right?
NRF2 will naturally upregulate glutathione production. I think sometimes we want to shortcut it and by giving more NAC or just giving straight glutathione, but as I said, if you give NAC, the literature shows that if you give N-acetylcysteine, which is a common supplement that people take or get prescribed to them to support glutathione production, as you increase NAC, the NAC inhibits NRF2. It would be better to support NRF2 and then let NRF2 drive glutathione production. Because if you're giving NAC or just glutathione, you may be supporting one pathway but turning off a whole bunch of other pathways.
Yeah, so that makes so much more sense, and I hope that really, you know, that message is driven home to my listeners, is that what you want to do is support the body to do what it does best. And there are glutathione supplements out there, but so important to understand that it impacts and shuts down this major pathway that is doing all the jobs we want done anyway. But just, you know, if we can just use something like the sulforaphane as the activator, then we're getting the job done and not interfering.
Right. And it's important that we, you know, there's somebody I'm sure sitting there saying, yeah, but I take NAC and I feel better when I do it, or I take glutathione and I feel better when I do it. And I wouldn't argue those points at all. But I think where you're going to run into trouble is not if you take it once, if you take NAC or glutathione, you know, once or periodically, but if you're taking those things on a regular basis, you may be addressing one piece, but creating problems down the line. And anybody who's been in functional medicine for an extended period of time knows as the longer their patient continues to bombard their bodies with loads and loads of supplements, they typically start to have more and more problems, because we give them for one thought process, but unfortunately, even supplements can have unintended consequences. So I think the safest way to support inflammation and oxidative stress is to, as you said, support the body's natural way to do that. And really one of the best products that's been shown so far is sulforaphane.
Great. And let's talk about some of the other benefits, because there's been some research using sulforaphanes in helping with some of the symptoms and conditions associated with diabetes. That's a big story there.
Yeah, so sulforaphane helps reduce your liver's production of glucose. And one of the things we see in people who are insulin resistant or have diabetes is they have a hard time getting glucose, that's the sugar, blood sugar, into the cells of the body. And so the body produces more insulin, and the liver winds up making lots of glucose despite the fact that the person's probably eating it. And so sulforaphane helps reduce this liver production of glucose in diabetics. So it's been shown that, you know, sulforaphane improves glucose control. Sulforaphane has been shown to help, you see in people who are diabetics who they've done some of this testing on, that not only do they see improved control of their blood sugar levels, but hemoglobin A1C, insulin resistance can go down. So it's really, really nice. It's been shown to help with leptin, get leptin levels under control as well, help to bring down cholesterol levels as well, all components of the diabetic condition, as we should say.
Well, isn't that amazing when you think about this one little molecule, how powerful it is in all of the ways that it really is optimizing our health and our ability to heal?
Yeah, I think it's pretty amazing. And I think the key thing for, you know, a listener to kind of keep in mind is the reason it seems like it can be so powerful and do so many things, as you and I start to look at the literature and the research, and it goes, it's helping cancer, it's helping diabetes, it's helping liver function, renal function. How could one food product do so much? And it's because it's not doing all of these things. What it's doing is turning on the body's natural regulatory system, or supporting the body's natural regulatory system. I think the best way maybe to explain it for a listener is, if the power went out in your house, sulforaphane is like turning on the main breaker that turns on the power in the whole house, every room, versus if you were taking antioxidants or individual anti-inflammatories, it would be like turning the breaker on in only one room. And so what we want to do is turn as much on as possible and let the body decide what systems need to be turned on, and that NRF2 enzyme that's in the body really is what then directs the actions. So instead of us trying to force a pathway, we support the primary pathway and let the body have its control.
Right. Well, that makes so much sense to me. You know, we just want to, you know, put that main switch in and everything else gets lit up and working.
Right.
Eric, is there what else have the studies shown about the benefits of sulforaphane?
Well, there's a lot. I mean, we know that sulforaphane, we talked about it already, supports detoxification. Sulforaphane has been shown to support the immune system. And so for people who have immune or autoimmune conditions, it really seems to have potentially have a benefit there as well. It helps prevent some of the damage mitigated by things, what we call LPS, lipopolysaccharides, from chronic infections. It supports, as I said, the immune system. There's a tendency for it to boost the natural antimicrobial activity that we need to help manage the bugs and the organisms in the body. So instead of maybe constantly, if you have chronic infections, instead of bombarding the body with antimicrobial, sulforaphane has the ability to have an antimicrobial effect by reducing things like biofilm that kind of protect these organisms. And if sulforaphane can help support the breakdown of the biofilm, then our natural immune system can get at, find and locate the bacteria, the viruses, and break them down on its own. Sulforaphane's been shown to help attenuate some of the bacteria, specifically like H. pylori. And H. pylori has been a bacteria that is on and off in the press. We see it associated with reflux conditions, stomach ulcers. A lot of GI conditions have a root with H. pylori overgrowth, and sulforaphane seems to attenuate it. Sulforaphane has been shown to be an antiviral. As I said, has antibacterial and antifungal capacities. We talked about its ability to be an indirect antioxidant. It's protective in the GI tract, combats inflammation at multiple levels. It can help attenuate pain. I mean, there's research on its benefits in supporting and preventing cardiovascular disease. I mean, we could go on and on and on. I have a presentation I use that probably at this point has 140 references as to the benefits of sulforaphane and growing every day. But for the listeners, you know, I think we see a lot of people trying to find, okay, what is the thing I can do to supplement my diet, my lifestyle that's going to have the biggest effect? And I think if you're looking at what are the biggest factor, you know, what can have the biggest impact, I think you have to put sulforaphane right near the top of that because of the impact that it can have in the body. And I would take sulforaphane any day over a lot of the things that most people would consider, like I'll just take vitamin D, I'll just take vitamin E. If you take sulforaphane, it supports all those things.
Well, you know, when you're talking about it, it's like this mighty molecule, right, that has so many jobs, but so few people have really known about sulforaphane. Why do you think that is? I think it's one of those hidden secrets for optimizing our health.
Well, I think part of the issue is it may not be sexy enough. I think it's probably one of the things from a functional medicine perspective, you know, if it can do so much stuff, I'm not sure if everybody's in a big hurry to put it out there because it may, impact sales of it.
Yeah, and I was going to say, because it impacts sales, that's disappointing to hear, you know.
But I think that it is. I don't think sometimes the solutions are as glamorous and sexy or get the promotional press that maybe drugs or some of the products that are made by pharmaceutical companies sometimes get.
So that's why this conversation is so important. It's really making people aware and educating everyone listening, including myself, of course, that this molecule, sulforaphane, that is found from broccoli sprout extract products is so profound. So profound in how it's supporting our body on so many levels. But before we end our conversation, let's talk a little bit about children, Eric, and how sulforaphanes can help children, children with learning disabilities, children dealing with autism. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, I see no downside to supporting children, especially who have neurologic or neurodevelopmental issues, with a sulforaphane product. And the reason for that is a lot of those things at the root of a lot of those conditions is chronic low-grade inflammation. And nobody's looking at it for the most part in a lot of these kids. So let's try and support that pathway. And you know, what the research seems to show is that within 15 minutes of sulforzyme or sulforaphane being absorbed in the GI tract, it can cross the blood-brain barrier. And so if we can get sulforaphane into absorbed, very highly absorbable, and it can cross the blood-brain barrier very easily, I mean, this is a massive way to help and improve somebody's brain, and especially a child's brain. And unfortunately, we live in a world today where the kids are just bombarded with stressors that can impact and damage their neurology. Pre-birth, through birth, it's just amazing how much stress is on the system today that, you know, just 10, 15, 20 years ago it just wasn't there. And so we need to have more strategies that we can use to support the kids that are just swimming in a soup of toxicity, and have these neurodevelopmental disorders. And sulforaphane has the potential to be a product that is low risk of toxicity because sulforaphane is gone pretty much within 24 hours, and the metabolites are gone in 24 hours. So it doesn't hang out in the body to become toxic. It's been shown to be a very, very safe supplement. And that's what we want for our kids. It's something that we can give them that's safe, that doesn't create toxicity, but has a massive upside.
You know, when you were going through all of the benefits of sulforaphane, you know, it deals with inflammation, it helps address viral overgrowth or fungal overgrowth, it helps regenerate the gut, the list goes on and on, all of which are issues that are involved with autism, particularly. Mm-hmm. So if we can support it, you know, we can support the body with something like a sulforaphane product, we're really helping these kids a lot.
Yeah. The benefit is the sulforaphane product, especially if there's some variety of the sulforaphane products that are on the market. What's really important is making sure you get one that's actually processed, has an active myrosinase enzyme in it so that it actually can do what you want it to do. But man, this is a great potential product if we're looking at something that can help support the anti-inflammatory and detoxification processes that in a lot of these kids are already compromised.
Yeah, that's where it's so exciting. So, are there any contraindications if we're talking about sulforaphanes? Is there someone who shouldn't be taking it? Is there an age limit? What else do we need to know?
You know, I have seen very little in the way of concerns with taking sulforaphane. If somebody has potentially sulfur sensitivities, they would probably not want to be doing heavy doses of it. There's really a limited downside. But I think with almost everything, if you're going to take a nutritional support product, your best bet is not to kind of wing it necessarily on your own, but to take things with a purpose. But I definitely think sulforaphane is a product that almost everybody to some degree could benefit from.
And, the last point we need to make, and you touched on it very briefly just a little bit ago, about the kind of broccoli sprout product that you may want to purchase. Because when I've looked into this, you know, what I've learned is that a lot of people are getting on the bandwagon with these products, but there are some very specific things people need to be aware of in order to choose the best one. Because if we don't have the proper enzymes available, which normally if our gut is healthy, we have the ability to convert into the active ingredient, sulforaphane. But if you don't have these enzymes because your gut isn't healthy, and that's like 99% of our population, that you don't get the full benefit. So you want a product that's proven to deliver the precursors that turns into sulforaphane. So do you want to just elaborate on that in the few minutes we have left, and then we'll talk about the recommended product that you like the best?
The issues are really, there's a couple issues with support products, and that's why the average person's probably not going to know whether they're getting a good product or not, because you don't know where that broccoli was harvested from. Where did that seed come from? Getting a clean product becomes really difficult. We found that issue when we were formulating the product that I use in my office called Sulforzyme. Not all the products, the broccoli seed extracts that come to a facility are actually clean. They have a lot of toxicity, a lot of junk in them. And so, that can be a problem. The second thing is how these products are formulated. If the broccoli seed powder is heat extracted, it kills something called myrosinase, which is the enzyme that is needed to activate glucoraphanin, another product within the broccoli seed, or within the seed or the sprout. And without that myrosinase enzyme, you can't activate and get sulforaphane. So a lot of companies buy a product that's heat extracted, and then all you have is what they call the glucoraphanin component, and then you put that in and you take it in the capsule form, and people are, and what some of the companies are saying, well, if you have bacteria in your GI tract that can produce myrosinase, and that will activate it. Well, we don't know what if you have the bacteria in your GI tract that can actually produce the myrosinase to activate it. So it becomes very, very variable as to if it's going to have any impact at all. So what we need to do is we need to find a clean product. We need to make sure that it is processed appropriately so it doesn't destroy the myrosinase enzyme, or it has a stable myrosinase enzyme added to the product so that once the product gets into the GI tract, the capsule opens up, those two components can come together and produce the sulforaphane. And so if you don't have that, and it's difficult sometimes when you read these labels as to knowing what you got, a lot will say broccoli seed extract, but what you need is something that's actually going to have a sulforaphane potential with that stable myrosinase enzyme. And if the product doesn't have it, you're probably not going to get the benefit you're hoping for.
And that's always the challenge, is how do you navigate the territory, right? You know, there's so many pitfalls in finding something that really is going to deliver. So there's the product that I recommend is called Sulforzyme. I'm going to put it in the show notes. People want to get more information about that. And if people want to order it, I'll have a link to my online store, which has the Sulforzyme, which I use. And we've come to the end, and I know you have to go because you have another podcast. You're so popular, Eric. But I want people to go to your YouTube site is fantastic. It's Rejuvagen, Rejuvagen, because you have so many great YouTubes that are educational. So, or they can go to your rejuvenancenter.com to learn more about your practice. But YouTubes are great. So it's Rejuvagen for YouTube site. Anything else you want to just add? Did I get all that correct?
Yeah, you got it all. I appreciate it. I know.
Okay.
It is. We're really happy with the product Sulforzyme, and we see some amazing benefits in those that are taking it and using it. So, power of the plant, you know.
Yeah, thank you so much. You've done a great job, Eric, in inspiring us and appreciating what the broccoli seed extract products can do for our health. And now everyone knows why I have this as a major part of my protocol. So you were brilliant at sharing all that information. Thank you so much for being with us today.
You got it. Thanks for having me on. Have a great day, okay?
You bet. And thanks, Eric. So all of you listening, check out Sulforzyme. We've been having this great conversation with Dr. Eric Balcavage. And until next time, honor the wisdom of your feminine self. Bye for now. No.